The views expressed on this program are those of the producers and individuals appearing on this program and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Sun Prairie Media Center staff, its video service providers, or the staff and elected officials of the City of Sun Prairie.
Hello and welcome to Real Reviews. My name is Jamison Rabbit, and the man joining me this week just missed out on Best Actor. His name is Mike Roth.
I know, and I submitted every single one of these shows.
Yeah.
I was like on, what, 50?
52.
At least 52 of them.
Yeah.
And no, they said, and it goes to Anthony Hopkins. I'm like,
well, at least you missed out on the In Memoriam as well, so
true.
That's important.
And it's also convenient because I wasn't invited to the Oscars.
These are all very important things. We're going to talk much more about the Oscars later on in the program, but first we're going to do what we do best, or I guess,
yeah,
do what we do, and yeah. That is talk about movies. And I'm going to get started with what we have on the marquee and streaming as well. Mortal Kombat, which is in theaters right now, as well as streaming on HBO Max, from director Simon McQuaid. This is the new enhanced version of the video game franchise that you know and love. The first film came out in 1995. This is a revisitation to that franchise that is tells the story of how our heroes came to fight the outer world in the battle for the realms. The film itself, normally, if you know the Mortal Kombat story, there's 10 battles for all the realms of the world. And whoever wins 10 in a row controls them all. And in the first movie in 95, we enter on battle number 10, right? And this one, we enter on battle number 10 as well.
Uh-huh.
And then we throw that away. There's no tournament. Don't worry about it.
No, and that was a little, because I keep on anticipating it. I'm like, well, this battle's coming. Battle's coming.
I think we're waiting for the next film for the tournament to actually happen. This is really more the story of how Earth's heroes gained their powers.
Mm-hmm.
We see Sub-Zero and Shang Tsung are trying to take over, trying to take them out, really, before the tournament even starts. You have Cole.
They're cheating.
They're absolutely cheating. You have Cole Young, who's a new character, played by Louis Tan. He's approached by Jax. They team up with Sonya Blade, and soon he's introduced to the Outworld realm and the world of Mortal Kombat, thanks to Raiden. And we also find out, Cole starts to find out what his dragon tattoo means, and that it presents special powers. They begin to train. This whole team of heroes begins to train alongside the Chosen Ones, Liu Kang and Kung Lao. And immediately they're under attack by Shang Tsung and his cronies trying to take them out and cheat before the tournament can even begin. And then there's a bunch of fighting going on. It's a Mortal Kombat movie.
And that's pretty much what you expect. I did like this a lot better, obviously, than the second installment of the Mortal Kombat
Annihilation
series.
Was awful.
That was terrible. It's kind of missing the snazzy music, and I really did enjoy the very first Mortal Kombat.
Mm-hmm.
Going back on it, it's dumb. This is pretty much dumb, but it was fun. And they poked fun at themselves, and they put enough little Easter eggs in there. So you know it's a Mortal Kombat movie. Everything that you expect to hear from Mortal Kombat, they say it, get over here, and stuff like that. You have the fatalities, none of the babalities or any of the goofier stuff. And you have the fighting, and it's well choreographed. I feel like Sonya Blade, Jessica McNamee, she seemed to yell all her lines. And
I did not care for her in this movie.
No.
There's a few characters in here that I felt like as characters were just thrown together in this movie. She was one of them. Surprisingly, I thought Liu Kang was underserved. Liu Kang kind of he was the leader of the first one, right?
Yeah.
And this time it didn't feel like he was fully in it for me. I wanted a little more Raiden as well. And
a little less of Louis Tan, who played Cole Young, who is a new character.
Yeah, but I think he was fine. I thought that actually surprising to me was Kano stood out as like the one character that like, okay, he's going for it.
Yeah.
I like what he's doing. He's fun. Mm-hmm. He had one of my favorite lines when he's training and he's fighting Liu Kang, and Liu Kang just kept leg sweeping him and leg sweeping him. And he's like, aha, I figured you out. He jumps, and then Liu Kang leg sweeps him again. He's like, you just can't keep doing the same move? I'm like, ooh, that's me every time we played. I'm playing something. Oh, you got one move, huh? Yep. Just going to keep doing that leg sweep?
My thing was get someone in a corner and do Baraka's thing, sure. Which wasn't in the movie, or Katana's thing.
Yeah.
And another one that was not in the movie. But they give a little wink and a nod that, yes, we are going to make a sequel.
Oh, for sure.
You're missing out on one of the famous original characters, Johnny Cage.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking maybe he'll be in there.
I think that's when then the tournament will begin.
Okay.
They get some more heroes in. I feel like I enjoyed this. Like, the fight choreography was really good.
Yeah.
I thought the opening was really interesting.
Yeah.
When you have Sub-Zero and Hanzo Hisashi.
Uh-huh.
In like a really beautiful battle. And what I really appreciated was you have Sub-Zero coming up, meeting this farmer in a field who would turn out to be Scorpion,
uh-huh.
and speaking Chinese to him and blah, blah, blah. And it says, you know, his subtitles are in Chinese.
Yeah.
And then Hisashi answers and says in Japanese. His answer is like, I have no idea what you're saying, but I'll gladly kill you. I was like, yes, not all Asian people speak the same language.
Mm-hmm.
That's been a thing in movies for too long. I appreciated that.
And I thought that was pretty cool,
too. These are different cultures.
They do have a feudal culture, too, where they don't like each other.
Absolutely.
Even today, they really don't like each other.
I thought there was some, for me, I thought there was some dead spots in this movie that made it feel kind of bumpy.
Mm-hmm. Waiting forever for Jax to get the arms.
Jax, I think everything surrounding Jax I could have done without. Okay. I did not like him growing weird robot arms.
Yeah, that was
that
weird.
That got bigger. Like, all that stuff with Jax felt like it just stopped the movie cold for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't dig on that, but I thought Goro actually looked pretty rough. I thought Goro looked like a rejected Bruce Banner.
I feel like he was an upgrade from the last Goro.
Well, yeah, but it's been 25 years.
I know.
He should have upgraded a guy in a rubber suit.
True.
But I was expecting a little more, and it just looked like a reject of the Incredible Hulk. But I don't know. I'm curious what you end up giving Mortal Kombat.
I really liked it. I gave it a 3.5. I didn't think it took itself too seriously, which is something that I hate about dumb movies when they're like, yes, this is real serious stuff. And you're like, no, just knock it off.
Just
it's not serious. And I thought the choreography was great. And it brings me back down memory lane because I did play this game.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. Yeah,
well, I'm a Street Fighter fan, but.
I watched all the Mortal Kombat movies, for better or for worse, in the last week.
I'm sorry.
There was a day where I just sat and watched them all, and Annihilation had me really questioning my life choices.
There's a reason why they didn't make a 3.
There is. I gave this one 2.5. Like, it's fine. I still think that. First one's more fun. Nostalgia is rolled into that, but 2.5 hours, not bad.
Yeah.
You know?
No, it's not good either.
That's exactly what
that
score means.
Right in the middle.
You know it. Let's move ahead, sir, with what else we have for our streaming spotlight. What do you have for us?
I have Stowaway. It's on Netflix, directed by Joe Penna. Anna Kendrick. This is really a movie with only four people listed. We have a shuttle that's going all the way to Mars, and they're going to learn how to grow stuff and, you know, how to start life on Mars. Unfortunately, we have a stowaway. Upon takeoff, they are missing an employee, never really got off the ship, and he ended up taking a ride, and it's unfortunate because they're not turning around. It's going to take, 2 years or something
just
to get to Mars? And, he's not going to get home in time for dinner. And this, oddly, is quite calm at first. This is considered a hard science movie based on real science things. And the first thing that I thought of wasn't something that they brought up until much later is when these shuttles go off, hard science, it's bare necessities to get you there and
to
back.
To the ounce.
Very smart people figure this one out. You add a person, that gets thrown off, and the question that ends up becoming the movie wasn't asked right away. They were like, yeah, let's keep this guy on board. He seems pretty cool. And then it comes down to the hard reality. Hey, we only have so much oxygen. Something broke. This is only good for two people. We could squeeze in a third if we're really crafty, but not four. We're going to have to kill this guy. And it brings up that whole thing of what can we do? I look back on Apollo 13, and I got all this hard science pretty much from watching movies in the past. And it disappointed me a little bit that a future movie, when we're supposed to be more enlightened and more intelligent, all of a sudden takes that step back.
Like, but, oh, no contingency plan.
Yeah, but I didn't enjoy the characters. Zoe Levinson, she's played by Anna Kendrick. She's always light and bubbly and makes you feel like the world is fine.
She's Anna Kendrick.
We have David Kim playing Daniel Day-Kim, who is that scientist that kind of knows what we have to do. And we have the captain of the ship, Marina Bennett, played by Toni Collette. And she plays the person that has to make hard decisions and tries to keep things inside a little bit until she can't do it anymore. Because, you know, hard decisions have to be shared. You just can't off and kill someone and not bring suspicion to the other people.
So I did like how they built up the unease and the internal struggle in each of these characters as the realization starts to come upon them, like, oh, we're going to have to play God up here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I liked that. Unfortunately, I felt like throughout a lot of this movie, they weren't sure if they wanted this to be like quiet character study space drama. Mm-hmm. Or sci-fi thriller, and I feel like at the end they're like, we're gonna go sci-fi thriller, and it didn't work for me. I felt like I needed to know these characters a little more than I did. It felt like as I was getting to know them, things shifted, and I also felt like they never really addressed the inciting incident of this whole thing when a guy falls out of the ceiling. You find a guy in the ceiling, it's never really addressed.
Oh, and again, that
how'd that guy get up there? What happened?
It's like, he was just fixing something.
Yeah, don't worry about it. He's fine.
He's just got locked in there.
Yeah, I was like, I need to
know
more.
Someone had to have closed the door.
I need to know more about this. Who shoved him in that compartment?
Come on, NASA.
There's a lot of that. And I just, I don't know. I either wanted them to really address, like, some serious things or to go. It felt like they were just trying to straddle a line that I didn't feel like they fully were able to straddle. Yeah. And then I really thought that the final part of the film was just really kind of pretty bad, pretty terrible.
Well, and again, it's not really on the hard science and the whole, like, going back and having the air condense.
It felt
in
like
an area that's there's no air.
Yeah, it felt like the final act. Like they had come up with that idea, and then like, okay, how can we fit this?
Yeah,
how can we make this happen?
It made a kind of a solemn ending to it. Unfortunately. Left a little not feeling great. And I like my movies making me feel a little better.
I know
better.
You do. curious, Stowaway, sir. How did it work for you? What did you give it?
I did enjoy it. All the way up to the end and things got a little bit more shaky. I gave it a 3.5 because I like Anna Kendrick. I like watching her do stuff.
She's super cute. I enjoy Toni Collette. I think Toni Collette's one of our finest actresses. I just wanted something. I wanted to connect with these characters more, I felt like. I just never felt like I was fully on board.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't really get to know a couple of these characters like I needed to. Yeah. I feel like the two male characters were unexplained.
Shamir Anderson, I might as well mention
him.
Yeah,
he's the fourth guy.
Because he's the guy who was a stowaway. I really liked his character, and I felt bad when people were, like, talking behind his back.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, we got to kill the new guy.
New guy's got to go, right? Look at him over there just breathing and everything, sucking up our air.
And they purposely make you care more because he starts talking about his family and stuff. It's like, stop that.
But ultimately, I don't know. I wanted something else. Maybe it's just me. I don't know. So I ended up giving it 2 stars. Two out of five.
That's not good.
Not good. I didn't enjoy it. I didn't have a good time with it.
Wow.
I'm sorry.
That's not even mediocre.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right. That's
less
okay.
Less than stellar. Sir, as we talked about at the top of the program, let's take some time here because last week was our Oscar picks and predictions episode.
Mm-hmm.
We handed out awards and we made some predictions. The Oscars have since happened. Let's do a little Oscars recap, if you will. Let's talk about what happened this past Sunday night. First off, the Oscars took place from Union Station, a whole different dynamic indoor-outdoor type of facility.
That was interesting.
It was interesting. opens up, Regina King kind of welcoming us, endearing herself to the nation by tripping immediately as walking up onto the thing.
She's a human.
She's absolutely human. Let's get right to the winners first.
Okay.
On the categories that we picked last week.
All right.
Best Animated, we both agreed to be Soul. It absolutely was Soul. Best Original Screenplay ended up being Promising Young Woman. Best Adapted Screenplay. No, neither one of us picked the father to win this.
No, but to our credit, no one was able to really see the father.
That's
and
true.
That is frustrating.
That is true. The supporting acting category. Supporting actor Daniel Kaluuya won it for Judas and the Black Messiah. And supporting actress was Yoo Jung-yoon from Minari. I loved her speech, by the way. I thought she was...
I liked her hitting on Brad Pitt.
Yeah, exactly.
That's pretty cool.
Pretty cute. Best actress. You predicted this one correctly. Frances McDormand walked away with the statue. And then, most notably, best actor, which we'll get into a little bit more, Anthony Hopkins won in a bit of an upset over Chadwick Boseman, who we both... I think both predicted would win, or possibly.
I think so, yeah.
Maybe. I believe we did. For director and best picture, Chloe Zhao won for best director for Nomadland, and Nomadland won, very fittingly, for best picture, which we both assumed was kind of the easy pick of the night.
Yeah.
But one of the things was, there's a lot of things that were different about the telecast.
Yes.
Trying to make it much more intimate, not as glitzy and glamorous, not as many people in the room. No orchestra there.
No.
So nobody's getting played off.
Sometimes I liked it. Sometimes I didn't.
There's a couple times where I'm like, okay,
yeah,
we could have somebody just play this off right now because
during the memoriam when
the in memoriam is a the in memoriam. So it felt like they were really messing with the pace of the show, and for a while I was really enjoying it. Like, we're moving right along.
Yeah,
this is okay.
Mm-hmm.
And that was to its detriment in a few things.
Yeah.
First was the in memoriam segment, where we're honoring people who have died in the last year plus now, because it's been over a year since the last Oscars. And we've had a global pandemic that's wiped out a lot of people.
Yeah, yeah.
And they chose the song that they wanted first. They wanted a more upbeat song than your somber Sarah McLachlan tearjerker.
Yeah, yeah.
And then they decided, well, we'll just match the pictures and names of those who have passed on to the tempo of the song, to the point where I couldn't keep up. And there's screen legends. I think I texted you, like, Olivia de Havilland, screen legend, when she passed, was the oldest living actress, got like a second and a half on screen.
Yeah, it was almost like someone going through their vacation slides,
and
they're like,
that's
not interesting.
These are all just Greg Hagen pictures.
This is my finger. It's a...
That was a little disappointing.
Yeah.
One of the other things that suffered because of this was they also removed showing clips of the nominated movies.
I couldn't figure that one out.
It's odd in a year when everyone said, I didn't get to go to the theater, so I didn't get to see a lot of these movies.
Yeah.
That was the biggest complaint was, I haven't seen most of these movies from people. Why don't you show a clip of why they should see them? Why we should be talking about them?
Another thing I found disappointing is we have not been in the theaters for quite a long time, so most of these things ended up streaming at one point. We got Anthony Hopkins, who wins Best Actor, also The Father, nominated as one of the top movies.
Yeah.
There is no reason. I understand all the other Oscars, they're like, oh, we got this rare find, and people just didn't pick this up. There is no excuse for any of these movies to not be able to be watched by everyone.
Yeah.
And it's almost a cliche that they're just like, we have to find that one movie that no one sees and we'll expose it to the world.
Talk
it's
about
like,
that, one.
That is not how awards should be given out. You should be able to see the movie.
It's frustrating. It was very frustrating for me and you, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. I mean, I saw a lot of movies. It's like, I felt like I'd seen everything.
Yeah.
And then to see like the lone movie out of all of the nominated movies in every category be the one that takes home two of the biggest prizes of the night. I was so frustrated.
Usually keep a good tab.
Yeah.
How many movies did you watch last year?
It was just over 200, if I remember right.
So out of 200 movies you've seen and you seek out the possible winners.
Yes.
One slips by. That is not right.
It was frustrating, to be sure. One of the other things that was really noticeable about the Oscars this year, though, was they removed the best song performances and put them in the pre-show rather than the main show, which I actually kind of liked.
Mm-hmm.
I feel a lot of times it stops the show cold. We're going, here's some awards, and then let's stop, commercial, come back, let's do a big song, dance number, commercial. Now it's been 15 minutes since anything actually happened.
This was the same length as all the other Oscars we've ever watched.
Well, that's
watched,
because they allowed people to talk for 5 minutes.
But it felt much faster.
It
and I watched it with someone else who's also watches the awards with me, and she's like, this was a lot shorter. And it's like, no, this was just the pacing was a lot better.
It was Yeah. Well, and they also made a lot of changes. I mean, they moved Best Director up, which is normally one of the latter awards. Mm-hmm. Suddenly we're handing out Best Director earlier in the show.
Yeah.
Part of me thought maybe it was because Bong Joon-ho, who won last year and who was presenting this year, mm-hmm. was live somewhere on the other side of the world. Okay. So maybe they're like, well, we'll get you in as early as we can. Yeah.
I looked it up, all the people that were accepting awards from Paris, and it's like they're up sober at 3 o'clock in the morning.
And that's part of the reason why when Anthony Hopkins won, he was not even on video, because he's an 87-year-old man. It's 5 a.m. at that point. He's mm-hmm. not up.
Yeah.
But they also, most notably, Best Picture, which for the entire history of the Academy Awards has mm-hmm. been the last award of the night. It's what we are all here for, is what's the best movie?
Yeah.
And we bump that up to third from last in a very interesting change of order, because the Academy was really banking on getting their big moment with Chadwick Boseman winning Best Actor. He'd won every award outside of the BAFTAs leading up to the night. Mm-hmm. And Steven Soderbergh, the director, was directing the Oscar telecast this year, put it in his theatrical aspect ratio, 24 frames per second, the whole nine. And he wanted his big moment at the end. He said, Chadwick Boseman's won all these awards. We're going to roll the dice and have a huge feel-good moment at the end. Mm-hmm. No way this could backfire on us.
Yeah.
And so we hand out Best Picture. And I mean, I think I was texting you when all of a sudden they come out and they start, here's the nominees for Best Picture. I'm like, wait, they're doing this now?
And I was like, there's okay, go to bed. And I'm like heading off to the bathroom. I'm like, wait, I got to go back.
So No Man Land gets that award. They come out, they do the Best Actress. Then the Best Actor, I'm like, okay, well, this is obviously going to Chadwick Boseman. And it does not. And the telecast ends with the Best Actor is, open the envelope, Anthony Hopkins, who is not here tonight. We accept it on his behalf. Good night.
Yeah.
And you're just left like, wow, that's the end of a... That's a terrible ending to a movie.
It's not the worst ending of the Oscars. The worst has to go to...
When you don't get it right?
Yeah, we...
Everybody come back up. Give me the...
I'm sorry. You guys, stop being happy. It's not turning out to be happy right now.
I will say that this does prove one thing to me. This mishap at the end proves that the Academy does not know whose name is in that envelope, because there is no way that they would have done this reshuffling of the deck if they knew that it was going to be a big oof at the end of the show. They had to truly believe that Chadwick Boseman's name was in that envelope. Otherwise, there's no way they would end it that way.
From what I've read, and this sounds terrible, this makes it seem like the Academies are irrelevant because it's all political. A lot of the people who were voted were like, Chadwick is going to win, so I want to throw one out to Anthony Hopkins. And it really wasn't because they thought Anthony Hopkins was the best actor. They were just like, oh, he should get some of the scraps. And that's not how best actors should be.
I'm voting third party this year.
Yeah.
Oops.
That's not how you should vote for the best person. The best person should be the best person.
I will say I do appreciate that Chadwick Boseman's family came out and was like, we're not upset. Why would we be upset?
Yeah.
It's not like you gave it to, you know, Sacha Baron Cohen for Borat instead, you know, like, look, it's a very deserving nominee.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, and it's bad optics too, I think, when you have this year being the most inclusive year as far as all-inclusiveness throughout the telecast and all this stuff, that still at the end of the day, your two big awards at the end, when you have so much diversity going on, are still given to the old white lady and the old white guy. it's not great optics, I just saying.
Yeah.
But, I mean, any thoughts that you had on the Oscars overall?
I did think it picked up. I think they really need to get out of this mode of playing politics and playing, hey, this person should have won an award for many seasons back, so let's give them an award now. Because it deteriorates the meaning of what is these awards for. Is it for your own posturing and make yourself feel better, or is it for really what it's supposed to stand for, and that is the best of the best?
Yeah.
They need to get out of this, and people are getting tired of it. They get lower ratings every year. This year,
record
58%
low.
Less
than last year, which was low.
And that was low. They need to get movies that people have seen. They need to get relevant, and they need to stop playing the politics and actually go for what is the best. I want, after the movies are done and they give out the awards, I want to be able to say, yes, that's right. And I was able to do that a lot in past years, but it gets feeling less and less accurate.
You know, the weirdest thing to me was when they would have the presenters come out, they wouldn't always come out on stage. Mm-hmm. And so when they were doing like the Best Actress, Best Supporting Actress awards, like at one point they had Laura Dern come out to, for Best Supporting Actress.
Yeah.
And she just stands in the middle of all these people that are sitting at their tables. And instead of showing clips, she's giving little personal testimonials to each actress. Like, I loved you in this. You were so powerful in this moment. And you were powerful. And instead of being on a stage where everyone's facing the same direction looking at her, she's just kind of standing in the middle. And so you get this weird visual of these nominated actresses like having to crane their necks to see her, like you're standing behind me, like,
yeah,
like this is who's making these choices. So they, weird.
What were the, okay, you said they were cameras.
No, actually I read today that those things sitting on there, that they were one, I believe, air purifiers.
Okay.
But then I also heard that one was a speaker because they're in Union Station.
Yeah.
And so it was a direct speaker because, you know, they needed that.
It kind of looked a little bit like a speaker.
Yeah.
And I figured maybe with the location, they didn't have the acoustics.
Yeah, I think that might have been.
It also could help as a translator.
You're full of ideas, Mike.
Yep.
I like it. So anyways, that's the Oscars. It's here. It's gone. Everyone got their awards and went home. And we're left picking up the pieces. Let's talk about what is going to be coming soon, though. Perhaps more Oscar-nominated movies coming soon the weekend of May 7th. We have a few movies. The first one is in theaters called Wrath of Man, which is the newest Guy Ritchie film starring Jason Statham, where we follow a mysterious man who works at a cash trucking company in L.A., and he is responsible for moving hundreds of millions of dollars. I'm just going to tell you, Mike, violence will most likely ensue. And it's Guy Ritchie and Jason Statham.
I'm guessing there's also going to be that slow-mo fight.
Yeah, there is. There's going to be some odd characters in here. Also in theaters that weekend, we have a film called Here Today, which is directed by Billy Crystal. And also stars Billy Crystal and Tiffany Haddish, among others, about a veteran comedy writer played by Billy Crystal who meets a street singer played by Tiffany Haddish, and they form a hilarious and touching relationship.
Aw.
So sweet. Over on Hulu, there's a film called Little Fish starring Olivia Cooke and Jack O'Connell and Soko about a couple who fights to keep their relationship as a memory loss virus begins to spread and threatens to erase the history of their love and their courtship.
That doesn't sound like a sequel to Big Fish.
Yep. And lastly, a film called Monster over on Netflix. This is Kelvin Harrison Jr., John David Washington, Jeffrey Wright, Tim Blake Nelson, but a 17-year-old film student who gets his world turned upside down when he's charged with murder and the legal battle that ensues. That doesn't sound like a good time. But those are all films that will be coming out the weekend of May 7th. Before we move any further, though, we want to thank our sponsor, the Marcus Theater Palace Cinema right here in Sun Prairie. We do appreciate you always sponsoring our show, showing us these movies, and, you know, maybe show us all the Oscar movies next year.
Yeah, that'd be sweet. Thank you.
I'm not going to bite the hand that feeds me, but we do appreciate your constant partnership with us, and we encourage you to check out what Marcus has to offer for you in a safe, convenient way to watch some movies. Next week, sir, we got a few movies we can discuss. We have an animated movie called The Mitchells versus the Machines. There's a film called Separation. There might be a Tom Clancy movie. Who knows what's going on? And much more. You're going to want to stay tuned for next week. We got a special surprise for you. But until that time, I'm Jamison.
I'm Mike Roth.
Thanks for watching.